Good morning to all of you. Please give your present to only host, not to everyone. Please make sure that whenever you are giving present, it should be to host only, not to everyone. Please remind that. Yeah, Vasundhara given me. Okay, good. Okay, so we'll start today's lecture. Now, yesterday we have discussed about the ecological succession, right? The successive predictable changes takes place during the development of community in a particular area. That is what ecological succession. Okay, in that last class we have discussed about this succession up to the hydrarch, that is the succession of plants which takes place in the aquatic conditions. Okay, so there are two types of successions, primary succession and secondary succession. Okay, in each succession there are several stages are there. The first stage is called pioneer stage, or pioneer colonize the primary stage, and the final stage is called climax community. Okay, so pioneer community and climax community. Between these two there are several stages are there, which are considered as transitional communities, as there are so many changes takes place during those stages, they are considered as transitional communities, right? All these transitional communities are collectively called seral communities, right? And then in primary, we have discussed about the differences between primary succession and the secondary succession in the tabular form. Okay, and we already discussed about the different stages of primary succession, that is hydrarch, in which different examples we have studied. So basically the primary succession is again two types. if it takes place in aquatic condition, that is called hydrarch, and if it takes place in bare rock or desert dry conditions, it is called xerarch. And whatever the transitional communities or stages present in those hydrarch and xerarch, respectively known as hydrozera and xerozera. So we have discussed in last class up to the different stages of hydrarch: pioneer stage, right, submerged stage, floating stage, reed swamp stage, okay, sedges, woodland stage, and then climax community with their respective examples. Now today we are continuing with the xerarch succession. That is, the succession occurs in the dry areas. Both are belongs to primary, where there is no pre-existing life form is present. Okay, it is completely a new succession. It takes place 1,000 years to complete to reach its climax community. So now we'll discuss about the xerarch succession, where it takes place in the dry conditions. Okay, now we'll see. What are the stages? The stages are same: Okay, how does it takes place? Right. Now, if you see this, right? The Xerox succession occurs on bedrocks. The habitat lacks soil, has intense light, fluctuations of temperatures and winds. That is a completely unfavorable conditions for the development of any of the community. Right? Even there is a unfavorable conditions, still there is a succession starts with the help of a pioneer species which are most important, that is lichens, or we can say lichens. Right? These lichens are mainly two types, crustose lichens and folios lichens. Crustose lichens and folios lichens. These are the pioneer communities, pioneer species, which start the processing of weathering. Now, what is weathering? The weathering means the formation of soil. And the formation of soil takes place on the bare rocks only. The lichens are the pioneer species which secretes acids and dissolve the rock. There are several acids are secreted by these lichens when they grow on the bare rocks, so that the surface of the rock get breaks and it modified into smaller pieces and dust-like particles, thus which they help in the process of weathering. That is called soil formation. Right? Later, after the soil thawed, the small plants like bryophytes hold the small amount of soil, and finally the trees are developed as a last or climax community form. If you go through the different steps in the pioneer community, the lichens are there. There are two types of lichens mostly, crustose lichens and folios lichens are there, which helps to form the soil by the formation, by the process of weathering. Once the weathering occurs because of the secretion of different acids to break the rock surface by the lichens, the soil is formed, and then the small plants like bryophytes develop on that particular soil, which hold more soil, and then herbaceous plants like herbs are developed, then shrubs are developed, and which leads into the climax community called trees. So it is somewhat the same process takes place in the Hydra as in the Xerox. So both are similar processes, but the pioneer communities are here lichens, which are develops on the rocks to form soil. Right? And in Hydra, there are aquatic plants like phytoplanktons act as a pioneer communities. So this is all about the Hydra and Xerox. Okay, if you take the differences between Hydra and Xerox, as we already discussed about the differences between primary succession and secondary succession, right? If you go through the differences between Xerox and Hydra, you can easily make the differences like Hydra takes place in aquatic wet conditions, Xerox takes place in dry conditions. Okay, the pioneer communities are phytoplanktons. These year final communities are lichens. Okay, so there are several differences. You can make these differences. Okay, so here this is about the succession. Okay, so we have completed the part succession. Now we'll move to the last topic of the chapter, nutrient cycling. As we already discussed about the four functional components of the ecosystem. Productivity, right? Energy flow of an ecosystem, decomposition, and nutrient cycle. We already discussed about the three different components, that is productivity, decomposition, then steps, and then energy flow of an ecosystem. And this is the last topic, that is nutrient cycling or nutrient cycles of the ecosystem, which is the last topic of this chapter, right? Now, what is nutrient cycles? Nutrients means there are different minerals are there, which are present in everywhere, right? In the beginning of the chapter, we have classified the things of environment, that is biosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere, atmosphere. Okay, so these are different spheres present around the environment in our surroundings. So in every way there are minerals are present, right? Lithospheres, the earth crust, which is also rich with different minerals. Atmosphere, it is a mixture of different gases, right? Hydrosphere, which is also composed with different minerals. So there are, all these are fully rich with different types of minerals, and those minerals are transported, are carried from one sphere to the next level along with the whole movement through the biosphere also. That means all these elements come into contact with all the things of the environment. That is called nutrient cycle. We already know the definition, biogeochemical cycles. Thus, the pathway of cycling of nutrients from different spheres like hydrosphere, lithosphere, atmosphere and biosphere is called biogeochemical cycles. Right? Basically, these nutrient cycles are, can be classified into two categories. That is gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles. Right? The nutrient cycles can be classified into two categories, gaseous cycles and the new sedimentary cycles. The gaseous cycles represent the cycles of different gases, like hydrogen is there, carbon is there, oxygen is there. And sedimentary cycles like phosphorus sulfur cycles. Now there is a full up source of these nutrient cycles act as a reservoirs where the source of these elements is present. Those sources are called as reservoirs, which stores these minerals and helps to circulate in all the element, all the areas. Now if you go through the nutrient cycle, right? Now here, if you go through this, the biogeochemical cycles or the nutrient cycles are cyclic exchanges, comma transfer and storage of biogenetic nutrients through various components of ecosystem. That is either abiotic or biogenic. That is hydrosphere, lithosphere, atmosphere and biosphere. So that the nutrients can be used repeatedly again and again. So these are the cyclic movements of minerals. Now here there are one more heading is there, reservoir pools. Now what is reservoir pool? Right? The reservoir pool is the reservoir of biogenetic nutrients from which the nutrients are transformed to the cycling pool. That means one is a storage pool where the all the nutrients are can be stored, and from that source they are transferred to the cycling pool where they can easily carry from one component of ecosystem to the another. Okay, so already we know there are two types of biogeochemical cycles, gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles. Right? Now, what is the difference in the gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles? Okay. If you go through the differences in the gaseous cycle and sedimentary cycle, you can find in gaseous cycle the reservoir for these types of cycles exist in the atmosphere. As we already discussed, gaseous means gases, that is nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, all these gases are present in the atmosphere, right? So nutrients occurs as a gas or vapor in the form of vapor in the atmosphere, and the movement of these gases are comparatively very quick and fast with the sedimentary cycles, right? Now, if you go through the sedimentary cycle, the reservoir for these cycles exist in the earth crust, that is on the surface of earth. These are non-gaseous and the movement of these elements are very slow. So there are three different differences. We can go through the gaseous and sedimentary cycle. The first difference between these two, the reservoirs are different. In gaseous cycles, the reservoirs are atmosphere where all the gases can be stored are present in the form of gas or vapor. In sedimentary, the earth crust is a source that is called reservoir. All elements are gaseous or vapor in the form, and sedimentary they are all non-gaseous forms. The movement of these elements in gaseous cycles, it is very fast. But in case of sedimentary, it is very slow process. So if we go through the examples, carbon cycle, nitrogen cycle, oxygen cycle, hydrogen cycle, all are gaseous cycles, and sedimentary cycles, phosphorus and sulfur cycles. Right? So these are the differences between gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles. Now we have to move with the discussion of gaseous and sedimentary cycle with the help of exam. Right? In our syllabus, the carbon cycle given as an example of gaseous cycle and phosphorus cycle given as an example of sedimentary cycle. So we'll discuss one by one. First we'll discuss about the carbon cycle. Right? Now you already know the carbon is present in the atmosphere and the concentration of carbon is almost 0.03%. So it's very less comparatively. Oxygen percentage is 21% in the atmosphere. Now, if you go through the carbon cycle, simply whatever the carbon is present in the form of carbon dioxide, it is absorbed by the plants during photosynthesis, right? And then animals and both plants release their carbon dioxide during respiration. So it is a exchange of elements from one component to the animal. Okay, if you go to the carbon cycle, now here about 49% of the dry weight of living organisms is made up of carbon, as we already discussed about the biomolecules, right? Like carbohydrates, proteins and lipids, all these are biomolecules made up of CHO. That is, carbon is most important element in their structural formula. Hence the 49% of the dry weight of living organisms is made up of with the carbon. Out of total global carbon dioxide, that is carbon, 70% carbon is dissolved in the oceans, which is responsible for its regulation in the atmosphere. So oceans can act as a reservoirs, right? So total global carbon, 70% of total global carbon present in the dissolved in the oceans. Now, according to an estimate, that is 4 into 1013 kilogram of carbon is fixed in the biosphere through photosynthesis annually. The photosynthesis is the most important process to fix the atmospheric carbon dioxide in the form of organic material, that is starch or glucose. Plants absorb this carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. A considerable amount of carbon is returned to the atmosphere by CO2 releases by the animals and plants during their respiration, and also by decomposers by their activities. The additional source of carbon for the release in the atmosphere are burning of wood, forest fire, and combustion of organic matter, fossil fuels, and volcanic activity. So these are all extra sources or additional sources which release the carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Burning of wood, forest fire, combustion of organic matter, fossil fuel, volcanic activity, etc. So, but major thing is photosynthesis. By doing photosynthesis, plants absorb most of the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. They fix this carbon dioxide into the organic form. And then animals and both plants, along with the decomposers, release this carbon dioxide into the atmosphere again by respiration and different activities by decomposers. So this is about the carbon cycle. right? Now I will show you the carbon cycle in diagrammatic form. Okay, here is a carbon cycle, right? Producers are there, consumers are there, decomposers are there. On the top, CO2 is there, that is a reservoir, atmospheric reservoir, right? Now the consumption, the combustions, weathering, volcanic activity, photosynthesis, chemosynthesis, the death and decaying of detritus, right? So these are all different activities takes place during carbon cycle. By respiration, the producers and consumers release the carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. By decomposition, the decomposers release the carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Okay. By combustion, weathering, and volcanic activity, the carbon dioxide released into the atmosphere. By photosynthesis, CO2 absorbed by the plants. So these are the different pathways through which the carbon dioxide move from one component to the another. So this is about the carbon cycle, right? Now the next one is sedimentary cycle, that is phosphorus. As an example, we are discussing sedimentary cycle. Now the reservoir of the sedimentary cycle is earth crust, right? So if you go through the phosphorus cycle here, phosphorus is the most important constituent of the cell membranes, nucleic acids, and cellular energy transfer system, as you know, right? Major constituent of cell membrane. Why major constituent of cell membrane? Because the cell membrane is a lipoprotein membrane. That is, it is made up with lipids and proteins, and all these lipids are phospholipids in nature. That is, every lipid molecule is associated with phosphorus. That's why they are called as phospholipids. So all these phospholipids present in the cell membranes. Then nucleic acids, right? DNA as well as RNA. If you go through the structure of DNA and RNA, the major three components are there: ribose sugar, nitrogen bases, and phosphate. So phosphorus is another most important structural element of nucleic acids. And cellular energy transfer system, that is ATP. During respiration, mitochondria synthesize ATP. ATP means adenosine triphosphate. Here again, phosphate comes. That is, whatever the energy currency of the body is there, it is totally in the form of phosphorus. So it is most important element of the body of any organism. That is, it is play an important role in the construction of cell membrane, right? Structure, it is present in the structural element with DNA and RNA, that is nucleic acids, and it is act as a energy currency of the body in the form of ATP, adenosine triphosphate. It is also present in many mammals to make shells, bones, and teeth, right? Now rocks contains phosphorus in the form of phosphate, which is a new natural reservoir, earth crust, right? When the rocks are weathered, or weathering is takes place, some of the phosphate get dissolved in the soil solution and it is absorbed by the plants. During weathering process, the soil formation takes place. During that process, whatever the phosphate ions are there, they are dissolved in the soil, which are available to the plants, and these are absorbed by the plants. And then the consumers, that is herbivores and other animals, get their phosphorus from their plants directly or indirectly. That is herbivores directly and carnivores indirectly. And then phosphorus return back to the soil by the action of phosphate solubilizing bacteria and dead organs. That is a decomposition again. So during the structure of ecosystem, we have discussed that is decomposers play an important role in the recycling of minerals. We have discussed about that. So that is what these phosphates again come into the return into the soil by using bacteria, right? Phosphate solubilizing bacteria. So they act on inorganic contents of the dead and decaying part of organisms, and all whatever the minerals present in that, they are again redeposited into the soil. So this is about the phosphorus cycle. If you go through the diagram or flowchart of phosphorus cycle, here I'll show you the two figures. The left figure is about your NCERT textbook figure, the phosphorus cycle, and another one is a different one, right? Now here rock materials are there, soil solution, then from soil solution uptake by producers, from producers to consumers, consumers to detritus, during litter fall also from producers, whatever it is, come return to the soil solution, right? So this is about the phosphorus cycle. So there are two types of cycles are there, phosphorus cycle and gaseous cycle and sedimentary cycle, right? We have discussed about the gaseous cycle with an example of carbon cycle, and the sedimentary cycle we have discussed by using phosphorus cycle. So these are nutrient cycles. Now the last topic, our last heading of this chapter is ecosystem services. Ecosystem services. Now what ecosystem services? If you go through the ecosystem services, as ecosystem provides different services to the biotic factors in presence of abiotic factors. Without abiotic factor, none of the biotic factor can survive in the environment. So the ecosystem provide different services to the biotic factors, which are collectively called ecosystem services. Now if you go through these services, here these are the services. The first is purification of air and water by healthy forest system, right? Migration of droughts and floods, cycling of nutrients, generate fertile habitat, provide wildlife habitat, maintain the biodiversity of the ecosystem, pollinate the crops by components of natural ecosystem, that is bees and insects. So these are the headings only, right? We already know the meaning of all these headings. Purification of air and water by healthy forest system. Wherever the forests are more, the atmosphere is very healthy, right? Migration of droughts and floods, wherever there is a need, according to that a requirement of nature, the droughts and floods takes place. It is a rule of nature. Cycling of nutrients, as we already discussed about the gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles. Generate fertile habitat. During the cycling of nutrients, the habitats get fertile, right? Both biotically and abiotically. Provide wildlife habitat. Maintain the biodiversity with the help of food chain and food web. This is the most important thing. Then pollination with the help of bees and different insects. So these are the different services of ecosystems, right? Now here, I'll show you one more thing. If you go through this, carbon dioxide fixation. The carbon dioxide fixation, that is the atmospheric carbon dioxide fixed into the biotic forms. The huge amount of CO2 in the atmosphere is removed naturally and fixed by plants into organic molecules and energy through photosynthesis. All other trophic levels, that is consumers and decomposers, depends upon this energy produced by them. So whatever the carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere, it is most of them, it is fixed naturally by photosynthesis by plants. Then the release of oxygen, again photosynthesis is most important, because oxygen is the first output of the photosynthesis by photolysis of water. That is called Hill reaction. We already discussed. So it is done by producers as by byproduct in this process of photosynthesis, which improve the air quality and supports the life on Earth, because all organism depends on oxygen for the breathing and respiration. And this oxygen is released into the environment by the process of photosynthesis. So it's the most important byproduct of photosynthesis. And even this is the first output of photosynthesis. Then dispersal of seeds, right? Various biotic and abiotic components helps in the dispersal of seeds for the growth of vegetation in different areas. Birds, animals, insects, and humans act as a biotic components, and water and wind helps in the dispersal of seeds. So these are abiotic components. So carbon dioxide fixation or carbon fixation, release of oxygen, dispersal of seeds, these are also most important part of ecosystem services. Okay, so these are all about the ecosystem services. So till we have discussed today about the xerox succession, nutrient cycles, that is gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycles, and their ecosystem services. We have taken example of carbon cycle as a gaseous cycle and phosphorus cycle as a sedimentary cycle. So this is all about the chapter ecology, right? If you go through the overall points of this chapter, we have started this chapter by definition of with the help of ecology. Then we have studied the structure of ecosystem, that is biotic factors and abiotic factors. Then we have started discussing about the structural and functional components. Now the functional components of ecosystems are productivity, decomposition, then energy flow of an ecosystem and nutrient cycle. Okay, we have discussed about the different types of productivity, that is primary productivity and secondary productivity. GPP and NPP, gross primary productivity and net primary productivity. Then the steps involved in the decomposition process. And then we discussed about the energy flow of an ecosystem. Then we have discussed about the food chains, grazing food chains and detritus food chains. Then food web, which is most essential factor to maintain the diversity of an ecosystem, as the food web represents the different food habits of organisms, right? Then we have discussed about the ecological succession, primary succession and secondary succession. In primary succession, we have discussed about the hydrarch and xerarch. And then we have discussed about the nutrient cycles, that is gaseous cycles and sedimentary cycle. And at the last, we have studied ecosystem services. So this is all about the chapter ecology.